Good afternoon. The first item of business this afternoon is portfolio questions. The first portfolio is wellbeing, economy, net zero and energy. I'd invite members wishing to ask a supplementary question to press the request to speak buttons during the relevant question. I call question number one, Ros McCall.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what plans it has to promote Scottish manufacturing.
Mr Tom Arthur.
Presiding Officer, through our Making Scotland's Future programme, we recognise how vital the manufacturing sector is to our economy. We promote this through investment that goes into supporting companies and the workforce. This includes our £75 million investment in the National Manufacturing Institute Scotland and its Manufacturing Skills Academy, as well as our Advancing Manufacturing Challenge Fund initiative that continues to deliver free support to SMEs. Skills Development Scotland have revised the apprenticeship frameworks for engineering to create more modern and flexible qualifications, and we recently held an Engineering as a Career event to encourage more young people into the sector.
Ros McCall.
I thank the Minister for the answer, but he will be aware of the recent RBS Business Activity Index, which shows a 12th successive monthly decline in incomplete business, with Scottish manufacturers blaming this decline on a falling inflow of new orders. Now, Fife has a long and dynamic history of being at the leading edge of manufacturing and engineering, with businesses such as Normand and Thomson dating back to 1905. And with the First Minister and the Deputy First Minister having pledged to get the economy firing on all cylinders. So what is the Scottish Government going to do to support manufacturing in my region and across Scotland that will actively boost the economy?
Minister.
Well, can I say the Member's absolutely correct to highlight the significant importance that manufacturing plays within our economy. Indeed, it accounts for some 173,000 jobs and over half of Scotland's international exports. So I completely agree with the importance that the Member stresses upon this, both in her region and across Scotland. We are committed to working constructively and in partnership with the sector to ensure that to ensure that manufacturing is fully supported in Scotland, and indeed, you know, we can realise our ambition for Scotland to become the home of manufacturing innovation. I've already touched upon the £75 million of investment in the National Manufacturing Institute, and indeed the significant investment that was provided through the Advancing Manufacturing Challenge Fund. We also look to engage constructively with a range of partners, including the UK Government on that matter, and indeed we also have our Scottish Government's innovation strategy, which sets out ambitions that will benefit the sector as well. So we will continue to engage constructively with the sector, with other partners, to ensure that we support a thriving, innovative and dynamic manufacturing sector in Scotland. And of course, I'm more than happy to engage with members with their particular ideas about how we can support manufacturing in Scotland.
Thank you. I've got a number of supplementaries. I'll try to take all of them. First, Gordon MacDonald.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The head of high-value manufacturing at Scottish Enterprise has stated that the energy transition is the single biggest market opportunity for Scotland's manufacturers, with the Scottish Government bringing vast opportunities to Scotland, such as the Sumitomo development. Can the Minister provide an update on the Government's efforts to incentivise growth and diversification in low-carbon technology in the Scottish manufacturing industry?
Minister.
Thanks to the investment by the Scottish Government and our agencies, Scotland now has an extensive manufacturing support infrastructure to help companies diversify and grow. Just last week, we announced £4 million of funding from ourselves and Highlands and Islands Enterprise to support the establishment of the Manufacturing Innovation Centre for Moray. Our Advancing Manufacturing Challenge Fund supported the establishment of 12 projects Scotland-wide, providing free support for SMEs. The National Manufacturing Institute Scotland and our Innovation Centre support firms in established sectors, achieve greater efficiency and also provide technological support to a range of projects in low-carbon emerging markets. Our enterprise agencies' strategic plans also highlight their focus on growing and strengthening Scotland's supply chain companies' capacity to enter such markets.
Paul Sweeney.
The National Shipbuilding Strategy refresh was completed in March 2022. One of the key recommendations was to enhance the competitive position of financing for shipbuilding programmes. Whilst there is a home shipbuilding credit guarantee scheme that has been introduced, there is still not a competitive product range on performance bonds and builders' refund guarantees. Could the Minister outline what the Scottish Government could do to promote greater competitiveness in shipbuild financing in Scotland?
Minister.
Well, again, I appreciate the member's long-standing interest in this particular area. You'll forgive me if I'm not able to respond to him in detail at this particular point, but I would want to assure him of the Scottish Government's strong interest and commitment to engage constructively in this area. And in that spirit, I'm more than happy to engage directly with the member.
Willie Rennie.
The manufacturing sector is watching the delay to the Berwick Bank offshore wind farm, and in order to get investment and confidence in the sector, it depends on a swift process of those consents. So ahead of the highly anticipated wave of applications for onshore and offshore, what confidence can the Minister give me that we've got sufficient capacity in consenting? In other words, how many vacancies do we have?
Minister.
Well, I recognise the importance of the member's question in regards to our consenting regimes and the need to ensure that we have robust but efficient and speedy decision-making. You'll obviously appreciate it's not possible for me to comment on any ongoing and live applications, but I want to assure them of the considerable importance the Scottish Government places in this area and our commitment to working constructively with partners and to support an efficient and swift consenting regime in Scotland, recognising the significant importance it plays on individual projects and also in ensuring long-term investor confidence.
And briefly, Jackie Dunbar.
I recently heard from a manufacturing business in my constituency about how they are now looking overseas to expand, purely due to how UK immigration policy has hindered the recruitment and retention of skilled employees. So can I ask the Minister what work the Scottish Government is doing to help manufacturing businesses recruit the staff needed to meet growing demands?
Briefly, Minister.
Scotland's Migration Service, launched in March of this year, supports businesses to navigate the immigration system, including advice from qualified advisers. We are working with our partners, including Skills Development Scotland, to emphasise the opportunities and higher average salaries in this highly skilled sector. Recent examples include the funding of a pilot to ensure those applying for opportunities with large companies and are initially unsuccessful are redirected to smaller companies in the sector with recruitment needs. We also sponsored a recent event designed to boost educators' knowledge of a modern and rewarding career in manufacturing.
Thank you. Question 2, Maurice Golden.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what elements it has identified that led it not meeting its household recycling targets in 2013 and 2020.
Minister Gillian Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Analysis of factors influencing recycling targets was published with the Circular Economy and Waste Routemap consultation in 2022. The most significant driver of performance identified as recyclable waste being thrown away. In response, our £70 million Recycling Improvement Fund is delivering modernised services and increasing in the quality and quantity of recycling across Scotland. The overall recycling rate in Scotland is at its highest level since records began in 2011. And our draft Circular Economy and Waste Routemap and the Circular Economy Bill aims to modernise recycling services and make recycling easier for households holders to address this very issue.
Maurice Golden.
I thank the Minister for that answer, but let's remember the facts here. According to the SNP, household recycling was supposed to be 50% in 2013 and 60% in 2020. So, simple question, in what year will the 50% target be met?
Minister.
Well, Mr Golden's right to point to the household recycling target is around about 42% at the moment. The overall recycling rate in Scotland as a whole is 62.3%. Across these islands, the Welsh have the best recycling rates in the UK, and their approach has been informed by much of what's in the Circular Economy Bill. They had an approach that gave more powers to local authorities to address household contamination and set targets for councils. And I'm in close contact with their minister, Hugh Aranke Davis, regularly. Indeed, he's working with me and other UK government ministers and Northern Ireland ministers on the game changer in terms of waste collection, which is a UK-wide deposit return scheme. But we might want to reflect that if our DRS has started in March in Scotland, as it was supposed to, 80% of drinks containers would have been recycled this year, rising to 90% next year. That would make a huge impact on our waste recycling targets. So let's just let the Circular Economy Bill go through, and also let's work with other UK nations to get DRS back on track.
Supplementary, Claire Hawkey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In Scotland, overall recycling rates are at their highest ever. Can the Minister detail how the Circular Economy Bill that she referenced in her previous answer will help to meet our ambitions?
Minister.
I thank Ms Hockey for pointing that out. She's right to say it's 62.3%, but there's an awful lot more that we can do. There is progress being made in household recycling, which is why the Circular Economy Bill and Draft Circular Economy and Waste Roadmap set out further measures to improve and modernise local recycling. This includes working in collaboration with local authorities and households to design new statutory standards for recycling to create a more consistent and easy-to-use service across Scotland. This bill will help us achieve our ambitions for a circular economy, drive up your reuse and recycling rates, and I'm willing to work with any member across the chamber on how we can make that more robust.
And briefly, Douglas Lumpkin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'll try one more time. When will the 2013 household recycling targets be met?
Minister.
The point about the targets that were set in 2014, the advice from the Committee for Climate Change has recommended an approach for targets for separate waste streams and carbon-based metrics. So the new targets may include consumption, reducing waste, reuse and recycling locally, and material-based and emission-based targets as a far better and more detailed approach than we previously had.
Thank you. Question 3 was withdrawn. Question 4, Christine Graham.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government what discussions it has had and will have with rural communities such as residents and businesses in Midlothian, South Tweeddale and Lauderdale constituency regarding the restrictions on the installation of wood-burning stoves.
Minister Gillian Mark.
I thank Ms Graham for that question. The new build heat standard currently only applies to new buildings and certain conversions. Wood-burning stoves can still be installed to provide emergency heating where justified, recognising the unique needs of rural and island communities. The Cabinet Secretary for Net Zero and Energy wrote to Ms Graham recently to confirm that we are taking seriously the concerns that Ms Graham and others have raised. Obviously, I'm new in post to this. We're urgently reviewing the position in light of these concerns and ensuring that we work with and communicate with all concerned parties, including businesses, as we do so. And I believe I have already said that I would go to Ms Graham's constituency to speak to one such business.
Christine Graham.
Thank you very much, Minister. I've forgotten I'd invited you. I'm glad you reminded me. A Minister referred to a letter from your 16...
Through the chair, Ms Graham.
Unless the invitation is extended to me. I should know better. I'm glad the Minister reminded me that I invited the Minister to visit my constituency. I refer to the letter that the Minister referred to me the 16th of May in response to the various concerns I had. And I'll quote... I'd like to reassure you that we have heard the concerns raised recently and we're taking these fully on board, close quotes. It seems that, in fact, with fresh positions in post in the government, that we may very well be doing that. And so I do again ask the Minister to come round my constituency with me, a second invitation, not many people get that from me, to evidence the log piles stacked beside cottages in the villages, log piles that are cheap and accessible locally, and then the Minister can reach out and understand the impact that it would have had had these been, I know, I appreciate it wasn't a complete ban, but had these been banned for usage in areas where they are essential.
Minister.
Graham makes a really good point about sustainable supply of fuels for these forms of heating as well, and I can assure that I take very seriously the concerns that she and many others have raised. And I'm happy to reiterate the commitment to urgently review our position, which I made in my letter of the 16th of May, and again accept that second invitation to go to her constituency. Meaningful dialogue with those affected, particularly in relation to concerns raised by Ireland and rural communities, will be key to this review, and I want to involve both individuals and businesses. I want to respond to the many pieces of correspondence I've had from members across the chamber on this issue.
A couple of supplementaries. First, Jamie Halker-Johnson.
My motion, which will be debated next week, recognises the importance of wood-burning stoves in those rural and island communities that the Minister mentioned. They're often the only source of heat and hot water when power is lost, and the SNP's ban could leave vulnerable households and communities isolated and at greater risk, as well as worsening high levels of fuel poverty. It has cross-party support, including from Christine Graham and from the current Deputy First Minister, Kate Forbes. So does the Minister accept that the Scottish Government has got this wrong from the very start? And will she commit today to reverse the SNP's ban on wood-burning stoves?
Yeah. Minister.
I think it's really important that I just correct Jamie Halker-Johnson. There is not a ban on wood-burning stoves. Okay, there are new regulations in place, and I know that Mr Halker-Johnson knows that, and I really look forward to responding on behalf of the government in the debate next week. I know how people who live in rural constituencies heat their homes. I'm from a rural constituency myself. That's why I initially liaised with the minister responsible at the time around the fact that a lot of them have it for secondary, a lot of homes have it for secondary use, and a lot of them will use them in an emergency situation. I am committed to taking on board a lot of the correspondence that has come my way on this particular issue and look about how we can make sure that rural communities are not disproportionately affected by what we do.
Yeah, and Emma Roddick.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'm pleased to hear the Minister commit to urgently reviewing this issue. I have had constituents reach out, genuinely unsure if they can continue with plan builds and housing associations and councils, similarly uncertain what the policy means for them. So given the contradictory information that is circulating out there, clear messaging from government is necessary to reassure rural and island residents. So, can urgent reassurances be given to those who are in the process of building green homes that depend on wood-burning stoves, a renewable and sustainable source of heating, and those who hope to do so in future? Thank you.
Minister.
Again, Emma Roddick makes a really good point about biomass being used for heating in rural areas and the sustainability of a lot of that. Current buildings under construction with a building warrant prior to the 1st of April are unaffected by these regulations. But for new warrants after the 1st of April, as it stands, direct emission heating systems, including wood-burning stoves, can still be installed to provide emergency heating where this can be justified. But I acknowledge that the current guidance can be difficult to reconcile with the nature of wood-burning stoves, which are often installed for more frequent use rather than just emergency systems. I am actively working to address those concerns. I am actively considering how we can give better direction in this area and work with all concerned parties to ensure I address this.
Thank you. Question 5 was not lodged. Question 6, Eleanor Whittam.
To ask the Scottish Government what discussions the Net Zero Secretary has had with ministerial colleagues regarding any plans to review any unintended impacts of the Fourth National Planning Framework on energy policy.
Cabinet Secretary Mary McCallum.
Presiding Officer, planning and consenting is key to realising the enormous social and economic benefits of our energy transition and net zero journey. Therefore, I regularly discuss these issues with my ministerial colleagues, including most recently this morning when myself, together with the Minister for Energy and Minister for Public Finance here with me today, we met with senior officials to discuss a range of related matters, including how we ensure our planning system can both protect our natural environment on the one hand and be a key enabler of both decarbonisation and green economic growth on the other, and crucially, how our communities can be supported and empowered in this respect. On MPF4 specifically, following the adoption of the framework in 2023, we are monitoring the implementation of it and taking action to support application of its policies in practice.
Eleanor Whittam.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Whilst really appreciative of the broader intent behind MPF4's energy policy principles and our move towards a just transition, many of my constituents have brought the cumulative effect of a high volume of wind farms, such as the 5 proposed in the North Carrick area alone, with turbine heights in excess of 200 metres, to my attention. Could the Cabinet Secretary explain how NPF4 allows my constituents to raise the impact this may have on their communities, their amenity, their private water supplies, and indeed to local biodiversity, and how can we ensure that these local voices are heard?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, on MPF4, which is more the domain of the Public Finance Minister than mine, but it does make clear the impact on communities, nature and others, including the cumulative impact that Ms Whittam is absolutely right to mention, are important considerations in the decision-making process, and all applications will be considered for site-specific assessments, and I would reiterate that local communities must always have their say. More in the energy space, we are aware that some communities are experiencing an intensification of renewable energy development proposals. Our planning officials have been engaging with communities across Scotland to support better collaborative working. It's also why we are calling on the UK Government to make changes to modernise Scotland's consenting regime under the UK Electricity Act. This would, amongst other things, require pre-application community engagement to become mandatory, something I think Ms Whittam's constituents would welcome. And we have written to all parties offering the opportunity to work with the Scottish Government in pursuit of this.
Question 7 is not lodged. Question 8, Annie Wells.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what measures it is taking to support businesses to address reported declining retail sales.
Minister Tom Arthur.
Our retail strategy sets out how we will work with businesses and trade unions to deliver a strong and prosperous retail sector in line with the vision of the National Strategy for Economic Transformation. The strategy sets out a clear vision for the retail sector in Scotland that is successful, resilient, sustainable and profitable. It seeks to build on retail strengths and maximise opportunities for the sector to fulfil its potential and contribute to our economic transformation.
Annie Wells.
I thank the Minister for that answer. The Scottish Retail Consortium have said that retail across all sectors in Scotland has seen a drop in sales on a year-on-year basis since April. Food sales dropped by 3% and non-food sales, excluding online, decreased by 4.9%. So, considering the SNP have refused to pass on the business rates relief, what specific support can the Minister and the Scottish Government give to our local retailers?
Minister.
Well, what I would first highlight on that specific point around non-domestic rates is the considerable support that the Government provides through non-domestic rates relief, valued at some £685 million this year. That's out of an estimated revenue of £3.1 billion. And specifically, a significant portion of that goes towards the Small Business Bonus Scheme, which the Member knows is a significantly generous scheme and is one from which many retailers benefit. More broadly, of course, retail is not immune from the significant economic pressures that we have been facing, whether that be the broader cost of living crisis or the response to the significant inflation that we've seen, thankfully reducing significantly. But of course, that has led to significant rises in interest rates, and that will of course have effect on depressing consumer spending. But we want to work, and we are committed to continuing to work constructively with the retail sector. And yes, recognising that regulation and indeed fiscal powers and taxation are an important part, but we have to work more broadly to recognise the changing habits that consumers have around what particular channels are used to access retail, and of course not seeing retail and policy in isolation, but in a holistic manner as a lie to our broader aspirations around town centre and local living, for example. So I'm very much looking forward to taking up responsibilities around retail, and I pay tribute to my predecessor, Joe Fitzpatrick, and the role that he undertook in taking forward the retail strategy, and I'm committed to working with all members constructively and the wider sector to ensure we have a prosperous and flourishing retail sector in Scotland.
And Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Does the Minister share my concern about the UK Government's refusal to substantially raise the threshold at which businesses pay VAT, leading to ever greater numbers of small businesses being forced into VAT registration? Despite cumulative inflation of 32% since 2017, the threshold of £85,000 was frozen for 7 years until a paltry raise to £90,000 was carried out as part of this year's UK budget. And of course, this has a very adverse impact on our businesses. And does he also agree that Labour Party advisers suggesting that be lowered to £50,000 is not only damaging to business, but downright irresponsible?
Matters for which the Minister is responsible. Minister.
Presiding Officer, well, as implicit in your much valued advice, the UK Government retains the majority of the tax policy levers to boost much needed economic growth. And I would insist that they ensure that the increase to the VAT registration threshold introduced in April of this year needs to provide value for money and give businesses the long-term assurances and certainty they need to support economic growth. So we will continue to call on the UK Government to provide businesses with the support they need to protect jobs and protect the economy. But I would say that the better solution would be for powers over VAT and broader fiscal levers currently in the hands of the UK Government to be devolved to this Parliament so that we can more holistically and effectively put in place policy measures that will support our economy and our economic needs.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes portfolio questions on wellbeing, economy, net zero and energy. There will be a brief pause before we move to the next portfolio to allow front benches to change. Okay, the next portfolio is Finance, Deputy First Minister Responsibilities and Parliamentary Business. I'd invite members wishing to ask a supplementary question to press the request to speak buttons during the relevant question. And I call question number one, Ash Regan.
To to ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the impact of the updated fiscal framework.
Deputy First Minister.
The forthcoming medium-term financial strategy will provide an update on the fiscal outlook and will reflect the impact of changes agreed to the fiscal framework, including the Scottish Government's latest borrowing and reserve policies. The Scottish Government has postponed publication of this year's MTFS in order to allow time for the incoming First Minister to take a view on critical policy issues and to align the fiscal strategy with the Government's wider policy priorities. The MTFS will now publish on the 20th of June.
Ash Regan.
Recent analysis from the House of Commons Library paints a very concerning picture, suggesting that Scotland's block grant will consist of just 3.5% of UK government spending in 23-24 and 24-25, according to autumn statement plans. Does the government agree that this underscores the need for a detailed explanation of how the fiscal framework affects Scotland's block grant and the overall fiscal autonomy of our country? And is it not time for a thorough review of the fiscal framework and the reprioritising of delivering independence to ensure that future Scottish governments have all the fiscal levers of a normal country?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, let me firstly say that it's no secret that the Scottish Government's preference was, of course, for a broadly scoped review that explored opportunities for further devolution. And, of course, our position on full fiscal powers and independence is there for everybody to see. However, the improvements that we made were important. It is a sensible and proportionate set of improvements to the fiscal framework, and it provides the Scottish Government with more effective levers to manage risk and volatility. And, of course, it ensures that we are able to lock in the index per capita model, which will ensure that the position compared to what it would have been will result in the Scottish public finances being better to the tune of hundreds of millions of pounds over the next few years.
Thank you. A number of supplementaries. I'll try to get them all in, but they will need to be brief. First, John Mason.
Thank you. And the Cabinet Secretary mentions the index per capita method, which I think John Swinney in his previous role achieved. I mean, would you confirm that we could be in a lot worse position if we didn't have the index per capita methodology?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes. I mean, the fiscal framework review was very limited in its scope and nature, and given it was a negotiation, the ability to expand that was very limited. But the point that John Mason makes is that the index per capita mechanism has, of course, significantly benefited the Scottish budget because it ensures that the budget is protected from the risk of slower population growth in Scotland relative to the rest of the UK. And without the levers over things like migration, it's very difficult to turn that around. And the authors of the independent report, which informed the review of the fiscal framework, estimated that by 2026-27, this benefit for income tax alone could rise to around £500 million a year relative to the Treasury's preferred methodology.
And Liz Smith.
The Cabinet Secretary was very clear at the Finance Committee and in this chamber that the fiscal framework, and I quote, has yielded a fair and pragmatic set of changes which will strengthen the financial management levers available to the Scottish Government. So can I ask that she recognises that the fiscal framework is something that is very valuable to Scotland and shows good joint working between the Scottish and UK governments?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I said at the time that given the limitations of the review, that it was fair and pragmatic. Obviously, though, we would have liked and will continue to seek, particularly if there is a change of government, a more fundamental review of the fiscal framework. But alone, the index per capita mechanism was very, very important. I mentioned to John Mason the benefit of potentially £500 million a year relative to the Treasury's preferred methodology. That is something that I think we should all welcome. But, of course, the fiscal framework could be further improved, and we will pursue that with the new government.
And Michael Mara.
Of course, the ultranationalist ALBA party described in a debate last December the fiscal framework as a trap. Does the First Minister think that an additional £2,200 per head public spending in Scotland is a trap, or does it actually help to sustain core public services?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, of course, Scottish revenues through personal taxation and business taxation provides revenues to the whole of the United Kingdom. So the idea that somehow Scotland is subsidised is not a proposition that I support. We pay more than pay our own share, not least when you look at the energy revenues that have flowed to the UK government over many, many years. Scotland more than pays its way. The point, though, of the fiscal framework was to recognise that while we are under these constitutional arrangements, that the risk of slower population growth in Scotland relative to the rest of the UK is a risk. I hope Labour will join us in furnishing the Scottish Government with the powers over population growth, like migration, for example, and having a migration system that suits the needs of the Scottish economy is something we would be keen to work with any future UK Government on.
If we're going to get in all the supplementaries in this session, the questions and indeed the responses will need to be a bit briefer. Question number two, Bob Dorris.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how it promotes ethical procurement processes across the public sector to embed principles such as fair work and sustainability, including in the college and university sector.
Minister Ivan McKee.
Scottish public sector buyers are encouraged to consider economic, social and environmental factors systemically through the use of the National Sustainable Procurement Tools, associated guidance and training. The tools have been designed to help public bodies comply with policy and legislation, including a focus on ethical procurement and the recently updated Fair Work First and procurement guidance. Scottish Government procurement policy and guidance encourages consideration of ethical requirements on a case-by-case basis, in a way which is relevant and proportionate to each procurement, enabling buyers to do what will have the greatest impact on a particular contract.
Bob Dorris.
I thank the Minister for that answer. Minister, PJ Foods employ around 100 workers in Maryhill and are a living wage and a living hours employer. I am informed by them they are disadvantaged by a UK-wide higher education procurement framework called TUCO and how it may be being interpreted by Scottish universities also. Consequently, a non-living wage company now makes a daily 400-mile round trip from Bradford to Glasgow to fulfil a university catering contract for sandwiches, generating some 124,800 food miles and 50,000 kilograms of carbon dioxide emissions each year. Can I ask the Minister to meet with myself at PJ Foods, visit the company to discuss how the TUCO procurement framework disadvantages Scottish businesses who don't supply products in other parts of the UK and discuss how that process can be improved?
Minister.
I'd be delighted to accompany Bob Dorris to meet the supplier in question, and I thank him for bringing this issue to my attention. And while public bodies are responsible for their own procurement decisions, I have asked officials to look into the issues raised by Mr Dorris so we can understand those more fully. What I can say is that since 2009, the Advanced Procurement Universities and Colleges, which is the procurement centre of expertise for the Scottish University and College sector, has worked to specify requirements based on menu plans that are based on freshness, using food in season and flexible and frequent delivery times, and have taken steps, including dividing frameworks into geographical lots, to encourage the active participation of small and local businesses.
Brief supplementary, Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. As the Minister will know, sustaining local work is supported by public procurement as much as we possibly can. It also, as mentioned by Bob Dorris there, can reduce the miles from manufacture to use, which is important for climate change. So can I ask what the Scottish Government will be doing to encourage and support local public procurement?
Minister.
Mr Whittle, I'm sure, will be aware of the annual report on procurement produced by the Scottish Government officials on behalf of the whole public sector across Scotland, a requirement in our procurement legislation that indicates that more than half of the £16 billion spent was spent with Scottish companies and more than half of that with small local businesses, a number which is far in excess of the equivalent numbers for the rest of the UK in terms of the amount of orders that are placed locally and with small businesses. That number in Scotland far in excess of that occurs across the UK as a whole, or indeed the European benchmark. So we'll continue to make progress to ensure that more orders are going to small and local businesses, and work to take a range of steps to encourage and support that. And the data will be in our public procurement reports going forward.
Question 3, Pam Gosnell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is regarding Scotland's budgetary forecast to reports that the UK economy officially exited recession and outperformed in the first quarter of 2024 forecast off the Bank of England.
Minister Tom Arthur.
Presiding Officer, this is very much welcome news that the UK has exited recession, a recession which Scotland avoided. But I think it's important that that is tempered with the recognition that the UK as a whole still faces significant challenges, with GDP per person falling over the last year, and with borrowing ending the year higher than forecast by the OBR. There is no sign of any improvement for our budget, which remains around £400 million lower in real terms than in 22-23, as a result of the UK Government's decision to prioritise tax cuts over investment in public services.
Pam Gosnell.
Thank the Minister for that response. While we are all glad to see the UK Government pull out of recession, we must ensure that the Scottish economy continues to grow as well. However, leading industry figures such as Sandy Begbie from the Scottish Fiscal Alliance have warned that increasing income taxes could make it more difficult for talented workers to move to Scotland. Now that the anti-growth extremist Greens are out of government, can the Minister ensure that economic growth will be placed at the heart of Scottish Government policy, and will he rule out an increase in income taxes?
Minister.
Officers, I would say I wouldn't describe any colleagues in this chamber as extremists, no. And I think that's an important point I would just want to put on the record. As the member will be aware, we have faced an exceptionally challenging set of fiscal circumstances, and because of the cumulative decisions that have been taken around the Scottish budget, we have £1.5 billion more and revenue to spend on public services, investing in our health service, local government, the criminal justice system, enterprise agencies and others that we would otherwise simply not have were we to have followed the policies of the UK Government. Now, we recognise it is important that we have a balanced and proportionate tax policy, and we recognise the importance of ensuring that Scotland remains an attractive destination for those on high salaries. And I'm sure the member will welcome the recent data that was published, the recent analysis showing that net positive migration to Scotland from the rest of the UK, and indeed in the last year in which we have data for across all tax bands. But we absolutely
thank you, Minister. I'm going to have to take a supplementary from Kenneth Gibson.
Reflect that.
So the UK economy is smaller now and living standards lower than at the start of this Parliament, the first time this has ever happened. Does the Minister agree it's a sign of increasing Tory desperation they consider it a cause for celebration that the UK economy has stopped shrinking, with growth still lower than in Europe, Asia, the Americas or Australia, as we continue to pay the price of Brexit and Tory economic incompetence?
Minister.
Well, look, Presiding Officer, the latest figures show that despite a small increase in the latest quarter, UK GDP per person is down 0.7% over the last year. The UK Government needs to face up to the fact that its actions are making the UK poorer, with the National Institute for Economic and Social Research estimating that Brexit has reduced the size of the UK economy by 2.5%. The UK Government's poor decision-making, typified by Brexit and immigration policy, means the Scottish Government must work even harder within its limited powers to help businesses and workers thrive.
Thank you. Question 4, Mark Ruskell.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on its commitment to consult on the introduction of a carbon emissions land tax for large landowners.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government is committed to reducing emissions from all sectors, including land, which was an area highlighted by the Climate Change Committee's recent report. We'll set out our approach for achieving this over the summer, and carbon taxes will form part of those considerations.
Mark Ruskell.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response? You may be aware that the John Muir Trust have estimated that maximising carbon sequestration in forests and peatlands could lead to emission savings of over 6 million tonnes of carbon, the same as taking 4 million cars off our roads. But it's clear that we've been too slow to realise this potential, which is yet another reason why Scotland has missed 9 out of the last 12 climate targets. So following that consultation period during the summer, can the Cabinet Secretary commit to introducing legislation at the soonest possible opportunity to ensure that that is passed then before the end of this parliamentary session?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I acknowledge what Mark Ruskell is saying around the John Muir Trust, and of course the proposal for a carbon emissions land tax is one of the options that merits consideration, and it should be looked at alongside all potential fiscal and regulatory options to reduce emissions from Scotland's land. In terms of the timeline, I'm not able to give that information, but I can assure Mark Ruskell that I'll update Parliament once that is established and we have more information to share. I'm happy to keep him posted.
Thank you. Question five, Claire Hawkey.
To ask the Scottish Government what assessment it has made of the impact of the reduction in Scotland's capital budget as a result of changes to Scotland's block grant.
Cabinet Secretary.
Our block grant for capital is expected to reduce in real terms by around 9% by 2027-28, a cumulative loss of over £1.3 billion. In addition, we've seen a 62% reduction to our financial transaction allocation since 2022-23, amounting to a £290 million reduction. This means we'll have to continue to make tough decisions to reprioritise our infrastructure pipeline to ensure that it's affordable, deliverable and provides the best value for money.
Claire Hawkey.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Westminster is set to cut Scotland's capital budget by almost 9% in real terms over the next 5 years, which will have a significant impact on my constituency. For example, there will be less funding available to build affordable homes, and South Lanarkshire Council will continue to refuse to build a much-needed high school to serve communities like Newton Farm, Drumsagard Village and Halfway. Would the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that it is deeply concerning that a potential Labour UK government are signing up to public spending cuts, doubling down on Tory austerity and further restricting Scotland's capital spending power?
Cabinet Secretary.
So the real terms cuts facing our capital budget are significantly impacting on our ability to deliver much needed infrastructure investment, whether that's in Clare Hawkey's constituency or across Scotland. I called on the UK Government to increase investment in capital projects to release Barnett consequentials for devolved governments. However, the spring statement provided no additional capital funding. It is absolutely imperative, and I hope everyone across this chamber would agree, that whoever forms the next UK government after the UK election has to change course, reverse the cuts to capital spending and invest it for the future. And if they do not, then they will be held accountable for that loss of capital investment.
Very brief supplementary, Willie Rennie.
I recognise those cuts, but with the reduction in inflation, there has been a release on the pressure on that, with an additional £229 million available as a result of that reduction, in factual terms. So can the Minister set out what that additional spend is now being allocated towards? What is the Government's priorities?
Briefly as possible, Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the infrastructure investment pipeline, of course, will be set out alongside the medium-term financial strategy on the 20th of June, and that will set out how we are going to use the capital budget available to us and what other levers we will use, and we'll set that out to Parliament.
Question six, Ruth Maguire.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the implementation of the fourth national planning framework, specifically in relation to the revocation of the special development order at the Ardeer Peninsula.
Minister Ivan McKee.
We are continuing our programme of work to implement the Planning Scotland Act 2019, and we remain committed to implementing its provisions, including those relating to compensation on revocation of a development order. When my predecessor, Joe Fitzpatrick, met with Hugh late last year, he acknowledged that resources had necessarily been focused on preparation of the National Planning Framework, but that we would look to take forward this work later that year, and that remains indeed the case.
Ruth Maguire.
I thank the Minister for that update. The sand dune system at Ardeer has been destroyed for commercial gain. And obviously, I understand the specific and complex circumstances around planning in Ardeer. I wonder if the Minister would meet with me to discuss it further with view to having a solution that will ease the concerns of my constituents in Stevenson.
Minister.
I'd be very happy to take up Ruth Maguire's offer of a meeting to discuss this matter, which I know is very important to her and to her constituents locally.
Thank you. Question seven, James Dornan.
To ask the Scottish Government what work has been conducted to assess any impact of repaying private finance initiative debt obligations on local authority budgets.
Cabinet Secretary.
PFI was an expensive mistake made by successive Labour and Conservative governments that simply did not deliver best value for the people of Scotland, and the repayment of which places significant pressure on budgets, including council budgets. For context, the total estimated payments for local authority PFIs over the lifetime of the contracts is over £15 billion, which is around 4.7 times higher than the estimated capital value of the projects involved.
James Dornan.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Glasgow City Council paid £61 million last year in PFI repayments, payments which will continue for many years to come. And of course, we also have the unforgivable impact of Labour's equal pay scandal, costing the same city around £30 million per year for the next three decades. When the council entered into these PFI contracts, Labour was in power at council level, in Holyrood and at Westminster. Given the financial vandalism of PFI to local authorities, can the Cabinet Secretary assure me that the Scottish Government will never return to the calamitous PFI model? And does she agree with me that it's a clear reminder of why the people of Scotland should never again trust Labour with the reins of power in Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
I can absolutely agree with James Dornan. The Conservative and Labour PFI models were an expensive mistake, which simply did not deliver best value for the people of Scotland. In taking forward alternative funding models, the Scottish Government will, of course, ensure best value for the people of Scotland in all of it, being at the forefront of the decisions that this Government makes.
Thank you. Before we move on to the next item of business, we've got another question in portfolio questions. I'd appreciate if the front benches would not be having a conversation across the chamber. Now, question number 8, Bill Kidd.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what impact the reduction in Scotland's revenue budget as a result of changes to the block grant has had on funding allocations to local authorities in the current financial year.
Cabinet Secretary.
The UK Government has failed to deliver for Scotland as successive fiscal events. When more support is desperately needed for public services, Scotland's block grant from the UK Government is less in real terms in 2024-25 than it was in 2022-23. Despite sustained UK Government cuts, the Scottish Government has increased local government share of the budget, and the 2024-25 budget delivered record funding of more than £14 billion to councils. The Independent Accounts Commission has recently confirmed this represents a real terms increase and follows real terms increases in both 2022-23 and 2023-24.
Bill Kidd.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that reply. The UK Government has cut Scotland's capital grant by 16.1%. That's the reality we have to live with. As Labour's Wes Streeting recently said, all roads lead back to Westminster. Does the Minister agree with me that it is imperative that all parties in this Parliament accept this reality and come together to speak as one in calling for an end to public service cuts and the impact these have on the money allocated to Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, of course, I'm very pleased that Labour's Wes Streeting has recognised the reality of the situation, and it's something I'm sure that his Labour colleagues in here will recognise, that whether it comes to health funding or funding for local government, and as it impacts the Welsh Labour Government, it impacts this Scottish Government in the same way. So I think Wes Streeting's realisation of the reality that all roads lead back to Westminster is something I'm sure we'll hear a lot about in this chamber from now on.
Briefly, Paul Sweeney.
Deputy President Officer, as a practical suggestion, Glasgow City Council has almost £500 million in LOBO loans running at rates of around 7 to 9%, far higher than the Public Works Loan Board. A similar debt renegotiation to that done by Newham Borough Council in London could save Glasgow City Council £450 million and £11 million per year. Could that potentially be an option for the Scottish Government to help broker debt renegotiation, cancellation and amnesties across Scottish local government?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, of course, the lending policies and the debt that local authorities have needs to be responsible, it needs to be affordable, and they need to make sure that it is sustainable going forward. And, of course, we engage regularly with councils and COSLA to ensure that that is the case. And, of course, the fiscal framework that we're taking forward with COSLA will look at all of these matters in terms of the affordability and sustainability of local government's finances.
Thank you. That concludes portfolio questions on finance, Deputy First Minister responsibilities and parliamentary business. There'll be a brief pause before we move to the next item of business to allow front benches to change.